how to kind of put them in conversation with each other. So I thought I would just read two short sections that might give you a sense of what the book is trying to do. So the prologue is called Chicken Truck. So if there's one thing that has led me to my current thinking about animals and disability, it is a memory I have from growing up in Georgia in the early 90s. Summers in Georgia are sweltering, humid, sticky, and uncomfortable. I vividly remember driving along the highways in our family car, which always seemed to lack air conditioning, being too hot to move, and drinking huge amounts of soda and water from big gulp cups. It was common to look out our car windows and see rows and rows of chickens on massive, fast-moving trucks. These chickens were alive, often packed so tightly beside one another that the truck itself seemed to have feathers. They were clearly dying, slowly being cooked as they zoomed down the road. They were scraggly, terrible-looking birds, sometimes literally falling through the wire cages that held them in. My siblings and I thought these trucks were horrible. Vehicles of profound cruelty constantly whirred by, and no one seemed to notice. The four of us would hold our breaths every time we saw one until it passed us. Originally, this just started because the smell was so horrendous. With our windows down, we could smell the dying birds and chicken feces before we'd even see the trucks. But eventually, holding our breaths became more symbolic. Not breathing was our way of recognizing that something deeply wrong was happening right next to us. In 2006, long after I began noticing these trucks, I applied to UC Berkeley. I'd been making art, mostly paintings, for many years and wanted to go to graduate school for an MFA. Before I left Georgia for California, I got the strong desire to paint one of those trucks that I had seen so often during my childhood. I had learned a few months prior that I lived mere blocks away from a chicken processing plant, which was the truck's final destination. As so often happens, this huge industry was invisible to most moderately well-off people in our city, tucked away on strange, out-of-the-way roads where the pollution, the smell, and the terribly paid, mostly immigrant workers would be out of sight. I had the idea of photographing one of the trucks while it was parked outside of the plant. I tried and failed to take the photo. I went with my brother Alex and my partner David, but we were quickly kicked off the premises. So I asked an acquaintance who did some work at the plant to take the photos for me. I got the pictures, but the person who took them was fired the very next day for taking them. These photos eventually led to a series of paintings of animals and factory farms, and in many ways they led to this book. I spent a year painting a large canvas about 10 feet by 8 feet of the chicken truck. At one point, I counted the chickens whose portraits I had been able to paint from the photo. There were more than 100. I wanted to paint a life-size image, but it would have had to be 3 times as long. As I painted, I slowly began to appreciate the enormous scale at which animals are exploited and killed in this country. My 100-plus chickens were but a fraction of those on the trucks that caged them. The truck was one of countless trucks that were delivering birds to slaughterhouses at that moment. United Poultry Concerns reports worldwide over 50 billion chickens are now being slaughtered every year. Through my research, I found out that the chickens I was painting were egg-laying hens, which are actually a different breed of chicken than the broilers used for meat. I learned about the cramped spaces these birds live in, and I learned about the hundreds of millions of male chicks who are thrown away every year in the United States because they are useless to the egg industry. I also learned about the hens themselves, who after about a year of egg laying are killed and made into cheap ground chicken as their bruised and debilitated, in other words, disabled bodies can't be sold at a higher price. These 100-plus chickens I spent a year looking at and thinking about inspired me to begin asking the questions that have propelled these pages. How does an animal become an object? How are we taught to view this objectification as normal? And how can thinking about disability help us to see animals differently? The feeling that first led me to hold my breath when seeing the hens caged on the trucks eventually led me to understand animal issues as profoundly relevant and even essential to other social justice issues, including disability. But if anyone had told me when I was first trying to take photos of those hens at the processing plant that I would spend the next 6 years and counting examining animal oppression through the lens of disability studies and activism, I would have thought them However, the more I looked, the more I found that the disabled body is everywhere in animal industries. I also found that the animal body is integral to the ways disabled bodies and minds are oppressed in the United States today. A thought struck me. If animal and disability oppression are entangled, might not that mean their paths of liberation are entangled as well? And then I'll read a short section from chapter 5, which is called Ableism and Animals. We need to crimp animal ethics, incorporating a disability politics into the way we think about animals. It is essential that we examine the shared systems and ideologies that oppress both disabled humans and non-human animals, because ableism perpetuates animal oppression. Indeed, ableism is intimately entangled with speciesism and is deeply relevant to thinking through the ways non-human animals are judged, categorized, and exploited. Disability studies and activism call for recognizing new ways of valuing life that aren't limited by specific physical or mental capabilities. Implicit in disability theory is the idea that it is not specifically our intelligence, rationality, agility, physical independence, or a bipedal nature that give us dignity and value. Many of us in the field argue that life should be presumed to be worth living, whether you are a person with Down syndrome, cerebral palsy, profound intellectual disabilities, quadriplegia, autism, or like me, arthrogryposis. This is not just some trite declaration of pride or a romantic assertion of the sanctity of human life. Rather, we recognize that much of what disabled people can offer society has been undervalued or considered detrimental by a culture invested in certain bodies and certain ways of doing things. Justifications for human domination over animals almost always relies on comparing human-animal abilities and traits. We humans are the species with language, with rationality, with complex emotions, with two legs and opposable thumbs. Animals lack these traits and abilities and therefore exist outside of our moral responsibility, which means we can dominate and use them. But isn't it ableist to devalue animals because of what abilities they do or do not have? Such arguments depend upon assumptions of abled human embodiment, as well as neurotypical human intelligence. The term neurotypical, which emerged from autistic and neurodiversity communities, refers to individuals or traits that are viewed as cognitively normative and species typical. As autistic scholar and animal advocate Daniel Solomon writes, neurotypicalism privileges a form of cognitive processing characteristic of people who have a neurotypical, non-autistic brain structure, while at least implicitly finding other forms of cognitive processing to be inferior, such as those natural to autists and non-human animals. Neurotypicalism is a form of ableism, and a recognition of the concept can help us understand the troublingly biased ways we judge animals. The fact that one of the most ubiquitous arguments people use in support of our continued exploitation of non-humans is that animals are incapable of a myriad of cognitive processes that human beings engage in shows the extent to which speciesism uses ableist logics to function. Presumed to be deficient in human markers of intelligence, animals are understood, to put it bluntly, as stupid. Their lack of various capabilities is often cited as proof of our superiority as human beings and as justification for our continued use of them for our own benefit. As disability studies scholar Harold Braswell explains, the very same notion of the able individual that marginalizes persons with disabilities also does so to animals. From the belief that man was created in God's image to the belief that human beings are the peak of evolution, our anthropocentric worldview is supported by ableism. Ableism allows us to view human abilities as unquestionably superior to animal abilities. It propels our assumptions that our own human movements, thought processes, and the ways of being are always not only more sophisticated than animals, but in fact give us value. Animals in their inferior bestial state can be used by us without moral concern, and those humans who have been associated with animals, people of color, women, queer people, poor people, and disabled people, among others, are also seen as less sophisticated, as having less value, and as sometimes as even being less or non-human. In fact, certain abilities and capacities are central to definitions of the human. They are thought to mark the boundaries between humanity and the rest of the animal world. In this way, ableism gives shape to what and who we think of as human versus animal. also fosters the values and institutions that perpetuate animal suffering. The various animal industries that exist in this country, from factory farms to animal research, rely on the public belief that using animals is okay because they lack the capacities that would make their use wrong. These industries also rely on ideologies of nature to justify what they do, perpetuating the idea that it is simply natural to use animals for our benefit, for instance. But even ideas of nature and naturalness are bound up with ableism because constructions of nature often conflate such things as health, normalcy, and independence with evolutionary fitness for ecological compatibility. Ableist values are central to animal industries where the dependency, vulnerability, and presumed lack of emotional awareness or intellectual capacity of animals creates the groundwork for a system that makes billions of dollars in profit off of animal lives. The very norms and institutions that perpetuate animal suffering and exploitation are supported by ableism. None of this is to say that ableism affects animals and disabled people in the same ways. For instance, despite being bound up in systems of scientific discovery and classification in ways that overlap with discourses of medicalization, animals are not pathologized as needing medical interventions to cure them of their animality, at least not in this time and context. And disabled humans are obviously not processed into meat or objects, although they are often objectified. Animals and disabled humans experience marginalization and domination in extremely different ways. My point is that ableism helps construct the systems that render the lives and experiences of both non-human animals and disabled humans as less valuable and as discardable, which leads to a variety of oppressions that manifest differently.